Good evening, everyone, and thanks for joining us for News 8 Now at 5. I'm Ken Kozorowski. Tonight, Nia Tao's fate is in the hands of the jury after attorneys presented closing arguments today on day 6 of the triple homicide trial.
Tao is charged with 3 counts of first-degree intentional homicide and possession of a firearm by a felon as party to a crime. So I was at the trial today. Nia Tao and Kama Nethratanasak are accused of shooting and killing 3 men at the Romskog Quarry on County Highway M over a $600 debt. For hours this morning, attorneys recapped testimonies, evidence, and their positions to the jury. Last week, Bridget Schlicht and Ratanasek, who were both present for the crime, testified. Schlicht testified last week that Ratanasek handed the gun to Tao, who shot all 3 victims. Ratanasek said he heard the gunshots while making a music playlist. The prosecution argued Schlicht's testimony was honest and worth considering, while defense argued Schlicht's testimony was a lie based on fear.
You got a picture of what it's like to be in the drug world and what people are like and how messy it can be. But something in her made her go to the police.
Only one person has a gun here. One person. Mr. Ratanasek. She's scared to death of him. That's the kind of fear you have when someone murders 3 people in front of your eyes.
So if Tao is convicted of first-degree intentional homicide, he will face a mandatory sentence of life imprisonment. Now that decision is in the hands of the jury. Ken?
That's Emily Haugen reporting. Thank you, Emily. The jury is still deliberating. As far as we know, a verdict could come in this evening, but the timing is not yet clear. In the meantime, Tomah police officers responded to a call of someone who had been shot at the city's Super 8 hotel. Police say they got to the hotel around 12:45 in the morning, where they found one man who had been shot, and that man was taken to Tomah Health. Police then responded to a report of a person bleeding at an apartment complex on Berry Avenue just 15 minutes later. Officers located another man who had head injuries, and that man was taken to Tomah Health and then flown to Gunderson and La Crosse. Tomah police say they are investigating. The man accused of opening fire in downtown La Crosse over the weekend was in court today. A judge set DeAndrew Grant's bond at $1 million cash. He's being held in jail on charges of attempted homicide. Police say 6 people were injured. Multiple victims were treated at the scene, and some were taken to local hospitals. Police say none of those injuries appeared to be life-threatening. A Holman man was taken to jail over the weekend on a police charge of first-degree recklessly endangering safety after police say he stabbed someone. 41-year-old Michael O'Brien made his first court appearance today. Police say on Saturday night they were called to Mill Street in Holman and found one person with a stab wound to the neck. Police say they arrested O'Brien without incident. The victim was taken to a hospital and is expected to survive. The state's attorney wanted a judge to set bond at $5,000 cash. O'Brien's attorney said bond should be lowered because he was attacked in a car, and there's a good argument for self-defense.
He came out intoxicated. He charged towards the car, as described by the eyewitnesses. He entered the car without consent and attacked Mr. O'Brien, at which point he was injured, and we know this because both the weapon and the blood was recovered from the vehicle itself.
O'Brien's attorney says he turned himself in after the incident. Judge Todd Bierke set bond at $1,000 cash. According to online records, O'Brien is not in custody at this time. Officials have released the name of the passenger who died in a car crash near Black River Falls over the weekend. 47-year-old Elivira Palomek from Chicago was transported to Black River Falls Memorial Hospital, where she later died. The driver and one other passenger in the car were also taken to the hospital. According to the Wisconsin State Patrol, the Jackson County Sheriff's Department and Wisconsin State Patrol responded to the crash on I-94 westbound in Jackson County. The crash remains under investigation. Several cities had their holiday celebrations cut short due to gunfire that has left 12 people dead since Friday. The weekend saw more than a dozen mass shootings from California to Illinois and Washington. Nearly 100 people were injured on Saturday and Sunday alone. So far, more than 800 children and teenagers have been killed by guns this year.
We also think limiting access to firearms in public is important. And of course, investing in community violence intervention programs will pay dividends and save lives.
A new report this month by the Johns Hopkins Center for Gun Violence Solutions found 2021 set a record for the most deaths ever, nearly 49,000. Last week, the CDC released a study showing homicide and suicides are now the leading cause of death for Americans 10 to 24 years old. U.S. Secretary of State Antony Blinken wrapped up a two-day trip to Beijing, saying the United States has no illusions about the challenges of managing its relationship with China. The comments follow Blinken's high-stakes meeting with China's president. Skylar Henry reports from the White House.
Secretary of State Antony Blinken spent 30 minutes face-to-face with China's President Xi Jinping.
The United States and China have an obligation to responsibly manage our relationship.
The high-stakes visit, an effort to ease tensions between the two countries.
Progress is hard. It takes time. And it's not the product of one visit, one trip, one conversation. My hope and expectation is we will have better communications, better engagement going forward.
While Secretary Blinken says both see a need to stabilize the relationship, China did not agree to move forward with reestablishing military-to-military communications.
I think that's an issue that we have to keep working on. It is very important that we restore those channels.
The two sides have agreed to continue to talk, but differences remain on key issues, from trade to Taiwan. China's top diplomat says his country has no room to compromise on Taiwan, emphasizing China opposes the Democratic Islands' independence.
China's sending a message, hey, we're in charge now, you're finished, to the West and to the United States, and I think it's indicative of what they hope to achieve.
Secretary Blinken says he expects more diplomatic engagement in the coming weeks and months. Skylar Henry, CBS News, the White House.
Blinken also emphasized possible cooperation between the two nations in areas of mutual interest, including climate and public health.
Well, we saw an absolute gorgeous day here to start off this new work week across the Coulee region. We saw lots of sunshine along with some pretty warm temperatures as those highs climbed up into the upper 80s here today. Now for tonight, your zone forecast calls for lows to drop down into the 50s and 60s in La Crosse County. We're looking at 64 tonight in La Crosse, 60 in Lansing, 61 in Stoddard further south there, and 58 in Westby, 59 in Soldiers Grove, and 61 in Caledonia. Now as we move into our central zones, we're going to be looking at lows tonight into the 50s and low 60s, more so the 50s further east. Further west, you're looking at the low tonight into the low 60s. And for tonight in the Chippewa Valley, mainly into the low to mid 60s there, with 64 degrees and a few passing clouds in Eau Claire. So here's a check on your 8-8 forecast tonight and also into early tomorrow morning, just looking at mainly clear skies to deal with those temperatures into the 60s and 70s tonight. And then we're going to be mainly into the 60s here as we head into early tomorrow morning. Back to you.
Thanks, Derek. Just ahead, one man is extra grateful for his neighbor. He says if it wasn't for her, his property would have been stolen right under his nose, and others might be at risk as well. Homeowners insurance is becoming more expensive and in many places more difficult to find. Climate change, rising costs to rebuild or make repairs, and a sharp increase in the premiums from reinsurance companies are the reasons behind this latest increase. Due to the risk hurricanes present, major insurance companies have already pulled out of Florida, leaving homeowners with no choice but to pay premiums nearly four times higher than other cities across the country. According to experts, the average cost of homeowners insurance in Wisconsin is nearly 40% less than the national average. And speaking of houses, real estate scams have seen a recent spike since the COVID-19 pandemic. One man nearly had his property stolen from right under his nose. Christine Lazar has more about the latest scam.
That old phrase, know your neighbors? Well, George Stance feels incredibly lucky to know his.
My guardian angel, my neighbor, Maribel.
Maribel Munoz noticed strangers taking photos and scoping out the vacant lot next door owned by George.
There were like three people taking measurements.
Maribel's a licensed realtor, so she looked up George's property and found that it was listed for sale on Zillow for well under market value. George called police and the listing agent.
According to the broker, it was an escrow, a cash-only sale, which requires no funding from banks, so it would close any day, the broker said.
George was days away from having the title of his mortgage-free investment transferred to someone else.
My investment gone. Is that close?
LAPD Detective Brian Calicchia is handling George's case. He says the fraudulent deal was done over the phone and with electronic signing.
All property information as far as title vesting is all public information. So there are people that know how to search for this information. And from there, all it takes is for a little bit of internet research to gain enough knowledge about that person to impersonate them.
Investigators say thieves mostly target property that does not have a mortgage and is under the name of just one person. A loan and multiple owners makes it more difficult to steal.
Now, authorities say they will continue to try and crack down on cases like this and advise homeowners to be cautious when approached about their properties. Coming up tonight at 5, if hot and dry weather conditions weren't enough for farmers, many are facing a new threat to their crops.
Sure was a beautiful start to the work week here today. Across the area, we saw those temperatures into the upper 80s with lots of sunshine. I'll let you know if the rest of this week will be looking similar. Coming up in my full forecast after the break. Well, after a warm and sunny day that we just had today across the area, our lows tonight will be dropping into the 50s and low 60s with just a few clouds to work with. 61 tonight if you're in Holman. Meanwhile, further south, Lafarge, you're at 57. Stoddard tonight at 61. Westby at 58 tonight. Gays Mills down to the south at 57 degrees. And New Albin at 60 tonight. As we head to our central zones, the further east you are, the cooler you'll be, as the lows are expected to be reaching those low to mid 50s with 53 in Black River Falls, 55 in Melrose, and the low 60s can be said further back towards the west. Now, as we head north into our north zones in the Chippewa Valley tonight, well, we're looking at lows mainly into the low 60s here with 64 and a few passing clouds in Eau Claire. So the forecast overall tonight in La Crosse County, 64 degrees, mostly clear and seasonable with those temperatures, and southeast winds light at 5 to 10 miles an hour. For the day tomorrow, we go sunny skies here again, highs reaching 90, very hot for this time of year. Southeast winds light at 5 to 10 miles an hour. A check on your zone forecast for tomorrow, upper 80s, low 90s in La Crosse County. And as we head into our southern communities for tomorrow afternoon, going to be into the mid to upper 80s here. Some spots could even reach the low 90s. Same could be said across our central communities as well. And as we head into the Chippewa Valley, we're looking at upper 80s and some spots nearing those low 90s, such as Eau Claire, for example. You're looking at 89 degrees and sunny for the day tomorrow. So here's tonight right now, just a few clouds across the area, but other than that, conditions will remain mostly clear throughout the night. Heading into tomorrow morning, we're looking at completely clear skies, and we do expect mostly sunny conditions again for tomorrow as well, as we are still underneath this upper level ridging of high pressure that continues to dominate our weather pattern here across the upper Midwest. And you can see that very strong ridge expected to extend its way north as we head into the day tomorrow and also into midweek here on Wednesday. That's going to allow for our environment to be pretty dry and hot across the Cooley region. We don't necessarily want that because we still need the rain. Even though we did have it here yesterday, we still definitely need some to work with. And unfortunately, I just don't really see this ridging pattern that you see here going away anytime soon. Now, there could be a little bit of a break here in that low as we head into Friday, and that could be a sign of what's to come, because we could be talking about some rain chances as we head into later this weekend and also into early next week. We'll get to the 8 day in a second, but I do want to show you that that ridge of high pressure that I talked about is going to be warming up our temperatures quite a bit. In fact, the 6 to 10 day temperature outlook from the Climate Prediction Center still indicates above average temperatures for us to work with. And in fact, you'll see it here on the 8 day forecast. Those highs warming up to mainly the low 90s throughout this work week. And then, as you can see, our low temperatures will be into the 60s. So just a mix of sun and clouds and pretty dry here for a while. Now, as we head into Sunday and Monday, that's when we're talking about a change in the pattern. Could be turning a little bit on the stormy side. And after all, we do need the rain. Back to you.
Thanks, Derek. Well, some of us saw a brief soaking of rain yesterday. It's not nearly enough to help relieve the drought conditions that are worsening for farmers. Kirsten Mitchell spoke with a farmer in Minnesota who says it's not just the lack of rain impacting crops, it's also the deer.
We have a clay mix, and normally it's not powdery like this at all. Like, this is... it's crazy.
At the Nelson Family Farm in Elk River.
We haven't had rain here in probably almost 2 months.
It's the drip irrigation system keeping these rows of vegetables alive.
You get tons of rain for like 3 weeks straight, and then you get no rain, and it's just, there's no consistency.
Justin Nelson's parents started the farm 37 years ago. The family wants to expand another 2 acres or so, but the land is too dry to plow.
The plow gets just stuck because it's like concrete underneath here.
The drought delayed planting and hiked up costs and labor.
Every time we plant a patch, we have to lay drip tape right away. It just takes a lot of time and extra money too.
With dry land surrounding the farm, Justin thinks the deer are looking for new food sources. Recently, they hopped the electric fence to get to their pepper crop.
We had a herd of deer that came in here and they ate like 50% of our peppers. If you go down through the rows, I mean, they nipped off the tops of every single plant.
More than 1,000 plants were destroyed.
It's very discouraging because you're just like, oh, I just put in all this time seeding these peppers, growing them in the greenhouse, planting them, all for them just to be gone.
They now use a repellent, which seems to be working.
It's all natural, an organic type of spray. And the deer can't stand the taste and the smell of it.
Another tool to keep them from being at the mercy of Mother Nature.
And if drought conditions continue, supply could dwindle, making prices at the supermarket definitely rise for consumers. With summer in full swing, YMCA summer camps are already in session to help keep the kids active during the long break from school. However, many YMCA summer camps across Wisconsin have had to deal with inclement weather and poor air quality due to the Canadian wildfires. Some campers have been forced to stay indoors as they follow health protocols, but organizers say they aren't letting the poor weather stop the summer fun.
When we're inside, we're in the gyms or the different studios. We like to put together a bunch of different like obstacle courses. We also have like some fun, I call them drama games. Still do have card games and board games and stuff too, to have a little bit of, you know, downtime. So it's not always super stimulating all the time. We can have some, you know, downtime, a little bit of rest time.
Whether they're outside or inside, the goal is to ensure the campers have a fun summer. But they agree they would rather have as many clear days as possible. When we come back, the horror video game and television phenomenon that's bringing the scares to real life this fall.
The news continues on News 8 Now. Expect more.
All right, do you think you can escape runners, stalkers, and clickers? Well, now you'll have the chance to try at Universal Studios when the theme park brings The Last of Us to life. Halloween Horror Nights is adding a haunted house inspired by the hit HBO series and Naughty Dog video game. According to Universal, guests will be propelled into a world of carnage and mayhem. They'll follow in the footsteps of protagonists Joel and Ellie as they try to survive in a world overtaken by a fungal virus that turns humans into infected monsters. Robert Downey Jr. is tuning up some of his classic cars into something more sustainable. In the actor's newest HBO show, Downey's Dream Cars, his cars go from gas guzzlers to eco-friendly machines. Downey stated that it's not a typical car show, rather a car show for people that may or may not want to be into them. He also hopes this new show can inspire others to swap out some of their parts for greener alternatives. Downey's Dream Cars debuts Thursday on Max. Derek's going to have one more check of your forecast right after this.
Here's a last check on your 8-day forecast. Highs mainly into the upper 80s to low 90s throughout much of this week with just a mix of sun and clouds and low temperatures into the 60s. We are watching for our next best chance of showers and thunderstorms on Sunday and also again into early Monday of next week. But other than that, conditions will continue to remain dry and hot. Back to you.
Thanks, Derek. That's a scorcher of an 8-day. Thanks for joining us tonight at 5. We appreciate your time. Hope to see you again at 6.